today we have Ginter, and if you don't know Ginter, it's really bad. He has done tremendous work for Scrum with his explanation of Scrum values that we also had to translate to two languages. I think it was very useful and helpful. And then, of course, the small book, a pocket guide. Now, for the second edition, I have to say you need a bigger pocket, but it's still quite small and it's very tense book to read. Yeah, that's the one.
See how small it is?
Yeah. So it's small, but it's not that easy to read. It's a lot of topics and a lot of information there. So it's good to read it a few times, if you ask me. We recommended that book highly. We posted about it also a few weeks ago. One of our coaches read it and he had great impression, and actually he felt like coming back to basics of Scrum and relearning Scrum, which is something that Ginter definitely taught me when we met. If somebody experienced training with Ginter, it's definitely very different training. I don't know if you still do it, but it's very kind of coaching and facilitation way instead of teaching and talking a lot. You are asking very deep questions that get people into more thinking and more understanding Scrum, actually.
Well, one of my big ambitions with everything is actually helping people to think in terms of Scrum for themselves.
And you call yourself independent Scrum caterer. So what is it about?
Yeah, well, that was during my time when I worked with Ken Schwaber as his sort of partner for Europe and so on, and Scrum the Talk. When I worked with people like you, candidate trainers. When I did that for 3 years, from 2013 until 2016. And then I wanted to be on my own two feet, be really independent. So in the beginning, I had to think, you know what, this happened. I left Scrum the Talk and you get all these things, LinkedIn profile. So, and you have to give yourself a title. And I had no title anymore because I was leaving my titles behind. Before that, I think my official title was Director of the Professional Series at Scrum the Talk. I had no title. I was like, yeah, but I'm a one-person company. What should I call myself? I could go for a traditional title. I am actually the CEO of my company. But I found that a little bit silly, actually, being a one-person company, and then because that would make me the CEO and the marketing director and the anything, actually. So that felt, and so I felt like, what if I would call myself, or what about give myself a sort of title role description of how I feel and what I like to do? And that thing popped up in my head, Scrum Caretaker. What I like about being a Scrum Caretaker is it's not just caring about Scrum and taking care of Scrum, but also taking care has this underlying notion of it's all about people. So that's what I like about being a Scrum Caretaker, caring about Scrum, but also caring about people, caring about how Scrum is perceived, used, utilized, whatever, by people. So and one of the ambitions I had in 2016, sort of 20, 25 years of Scrum, I felt then, and I still feel like that now, that we have achieved huge improvements in our world, thanks to Scrum. But it's still in a very technical way. We have moved away from projects into more product-like thinking. We have been able to get cross-functional and even cross-fertilization thinking, certainly on the development side, the IT, the whatever side, it's sort of technical side of things. All great, but it's all very, still very technical about creating and building and releasing whatever better products, faster, sooner, and so on. I miss a little bit the human aspect of Scrum, the people aspect. And funny enough, we're going to talk about that today, because I believe that if we use Scrum to build better products, if we want to do that even in an even more improved way, it means giving people room, that self-organization aspect, giving people room to build better products, rather than pushing and imposing and instructing and so on. So what I missed is the first 20, 25 years of Scrum, sort of technical focus on Scrum, building better products. Yeah, what about people development in Scrum? From the hope, belief, and observation that people that like to do what they do, give them the freedom, they will build better products. And the room to build better products, if that is really what you want to do, it will make you more happy, more fun, more engaged at work. So those two things, and I think I'm sort of trying to restore a little bit of balance. So it's not just about products, it's also about people, because the people aspect will reinforce the product aspect. And that's for me the Scrum caretaker thing. And then after a while I added independent to that. I'm obviously very, very much into the Scrum.org community, but also want to be more than just a Scrum.org guy. So I teach the classes, and that's also the independent. And it's also happened a little bit because you shared my little green book. I know if anybody's seen, there's a new book out. It's called 97 Things Every Scrum Practitioner Should Know. And as you can see, it's got all these beautiful authors on the cover. Besides me, 68 people. They created 97 articles about Scrum. And these people on there that I've invited to participate and contribute to the book, regardless of their organization, regardless of name, fame, whatever, people that I've worked with, people that I know, there are trainers, there are non-trainers, some people that the publisher brought up. So a beautiful and I think independent collection of people. There are CSTs, there's Scrum Alliance, there's less people. And that's sort of the independent thing. And what is great about the book, and I hope about what I do, that it's all about Scrum. So at the heart of what I do is about Scrum. And Scrum is not just there for products, but also for people and helping people or reinforcing people development.
So today you're going to tell us about engagement.
So I've got two things for people if you're listening in. So I've got a PowerPoint, but let's first start with something else. It's a Mentimeter or a Menti thing. By the way, I still haven't figured out, I like to give you the option of a heart or a cat. I have no idea why. And just think for yourself why you're intuitively choosing for the cat or for the heart. Okay, so thank you very much. Thank you very much for being here. Thank you, Christian, Andre, for inviting me. And indeed, you did a couple of translations of including Scrum Glossary, but certainly the text of the Scrum values, both to Polish and Ukrainian. Much, much, much appreciated. So everybody, I would like to start with the following. You know, this idea of business outcomes, it still matters, even in the world of Scrum. It's not just some sort of free play, whatever. It's all about business outcomes. Now, I would like you to think about your current organization, where you are employed, or that you have an assignment with, whatever. Currently in your organization, what do they measure? What do they monitor? What are their metrics? What are their measurements? Whatever, KPIs, whatever, in terms of performance and productivity. So the ability to produce business outcomes. What are people, organizations currently measuring? So can you think about it, and you can enter three keywords. Oh, thank you. So velocity, revenue, cycle time, sales volume, hours burned. Okay, thank you. Keep them coming. Some done increments. Story points, the number of story points delivered, or often the number of story points burned, or sometimes hours burned. Time to market, the costs, revenues. Okay, cool. So we've got 51 people participating. In general, people have a good internet connection, so I know you can do this. Okay, so let's give you a sort of countdown, 30 seconds to... EBITDA, I've never had somebody enter that. Earnings before interest, depreciation, and taxation. Anybody ever heard about that? Throughput, main hours. It seems that at the heart of it, we've got a sort of, can I say, a winner. It's called velocity. It's almost like a dream come true. Sort of not really, but it's what we see a lot. Companies measuring their velocity. Okay, thank you. So a lot of things that are being measured. Let me switch to my PowerPoint if you're okay with that. Yeah, okay. I hope you can see my screen. You're never sure with Zoom. I've quite some experience. So here was the question. So you've got this beautiful word cloud. So thank you for entering what are currently people measuring. Now, here's the next statement. And maybe first in the Mentimeter again. I've got the statement over here. Same statement. So different entry. Employees, my statement, employees who are engaged actually care a lot more. Like things about team outcomes, outcomes for customers, consumers, enterprise, and so on. So quick thumbs up or thumbs down. Employees who are engaged actually care a lot more. So it seems that we've got all agreements. Scary thing, maybe somebody want to play a joke on me and say, oh no, that's not true. So this is the sort of statement that we all relate to in general. It's obvious. It seems to be not so obvious to really act upon this, let's say, this belief. So employees who are engaged actually care a lot more. So thank you for that. I honestly believe that, but I'm not sure what we're doing with it or if it's really happening. Let me share why. A while ago, I think it's almost 2 years ago, I wrote an article for a Dutch company. They have a Agile magazine out, very glossy, beautiful thing. And they asked me to think about performance and productivity, but performance more like in the sense of like performance review types of things. Personal performance, individual performance, whatever you want to call it. Performance and productivity, but mainly performance in my world. Now, my world is Scrum. So I had a look at it and then I remembered, oh yeah, there's this beautiful report. It's by the Gallup Institute. You see it on the screen. And every couple of years, they bring out an update of their report and it's called the State of the Global Workplace. Now, the latest available report is from 2017. It's got data from 2014 until 2016. Now, a little secret already, those figures have been rather stable over the years. They have slightly improved. But what do they find as an overall finding in their report? That the level of engagement overall globally at a worldwide scale is not too impressive. Meaning from this survey, which they do across the world, they ask a number of questions to people. From their survey, it turns out that only 15% of the workforce globally says, yeah, I'm really engaged, meaning I love coming to work, I'm spirited, I'm full of energy, I love my company, I'm going the extra mile, I'm really doing more than just maybe my job or whatever description. Only 15%, meaning 85% is not engaged. And it's even worse, from those 85%, a proportion, meaning 80% of total, is actively disengaged. Meaning 67% says, well, you know what, not cold, not warm, couldn't care less in a way. Hoping to go back home as quickly as possible throughout the day, but that's about it. So in a sort of passive state. Now, actively disengaged, meaning almost actively working against the company, almost undoing the work of those 15%. That is really, really scary. I'm assuming we have a lot of people from Poland. To give you an indication, currently in that report, you're still part of what they call Eastern Europe. And it seems that your Eastern Europe in general is about at the level of the world, meaning 50%, 69, 16. In Poland, you're slightly below that, but let's say you're sort of world average. To make you feel better, I live in Belgium, I live in Antwerp in Belgium. A lot of people seem to think I'm in the Netherlands. I'm not. I'm from Belgium, for better or for worse. In Belgium, we score even worse. We've got 10%, 73%. Now, 15% or 10% or 11% or 14%, actually even 19, 25, 31% is not too impressive. Meaning a majority, a vast majority of our workforces, people that are employed by a company, by an organization, are not engaged for the company. That is not good, because we spend a lot of time in the workplace. We spend a lot of hours there. Imagine that we would go not just home to do stuff that we really like to do, but also go to work and do stuff that we really want to do, that we like to do. And that would be expressed as engagement, right? So that's really scary. That got me thinking a lot, because actually, you know, Christian already referred to it, the Scrum values. One of the Scrum values is commitment, quite an important one, although it was a lot misinterpreted in the past and abused even. Like, actually, the measurement velocity is probably the most abused metric in our beautiful world, at least not used for what it was intended. And the most funny thing, by the way, is that velocity is not even in the Scrum guide as a word. So it's sort of overemphasized a lot in organizations. But engagement for me is much in line with what commitment was intended to be in Scrum. Yeah, being dedicated to something, believing in something, going for it. Yeah? And the abuse was often in the past of the word was forcing people to do something, although it wasn't maybe not even possible. That was not commitment. Commitment was more about the effort, not necessarily about the outcome. Meaning it is never intended as a hard-coded promise of some sort of fixed outcome. It was more about the effort, dedication. And I think actually that this, it's from the dictionary, that comparison to a coach, a trainer of a sports team, saying, oh my God, we have lost the game, but you know what? I cannot fault my players for their commitment. They worked hard, they tried everything, they turned it into a hard game, they kept going for it until the last minute, they changed tactics, we tried lots of things. In the end, we didn't win, but our commitment was huge. And I think that is really important. But if we see at a level of engagement in our organizations, worldwide, Belgium and Poland and many other countries, I wonder, what is wrong? Why are people not feeling invited to show commitment, to go, to be dedicated, go for it, believe in it, try hard, change, do other stuff, try something new, try something differently? So that got me thinking a lot. So engagement and commitment are very similar. I personally like the term engagement a little bit more, because it has this more of an positive feel to it. Yeah. Now I've got a next question for you. So we agree that engagement is really important, because we actually agree that engaged people, engaged employees, engaged teams actually care a lot more. Why is then that we have so low levels of engagement? What do you think is needed, or what is missing, to have an environment where people can actually engage, where people feel invited to engage? So, looking forward to hear some keywords for you. So what is needed? What is missing in a way? What should be needed first and foremost to set up that sort of environment where people would engage, where they would show their creativity, go the extra mile?
Mm-hmm. Internet, just in meantime, mm-hmm. we as usually happens when you put some resources like this, like some study and chaos reports and stuff, there are questions about validity of the source, and there's one question about how many were involved in the study, in the Gallup study.
Yeah.
And there's a second question also about the linkage between cultural differences by Hofstede, like masculinity.
Okay, so the report actually is open for everybody, so you just have to register, so you don't have to pay for it. So have a look at it. It's quite extensive. I'm not a statistician. I read the report, had a look at it, and I like it because it resonates with me. It connects to what I see happening on the work floor, what I see happening with a lot of organizations. So have a look at it. And actually, the funny thing, Christian, is that this is a, can I say that, sort of very Polish question. So that means you're probably very skeptical, yeah. People, critical. So that's really good. That's, have a look, download the report, have a look for yourself. I tend to find it very credible because I recognize a lot of stuff that I see happening on the work floor. So I did not dig into the statistics and the figures and the amounts. I had I did have a look at the questions and so on. They make the distinction between people that are self-employed, working for a commercial organization, working for government organizations. So there's a lot of more details that I'm highlighting here. I'm just using it to give some sort of background and even a little bit of foundation to what I see happening in a lot of organizations. People coming in, not energized, not happy, from 9 to 4 or 5, watching their watch or their clock all the time, hoping that they can go home as quickly as possible. So what I'm missing is, what are we doing with Scrum to build an environment where people can actually engage again?
There's another one, actually, about not believing in US and Canada scoring so high.
Yeah, I did not look into that. I had that same question last week. I have no idea. I'm trying to be not skeptical or cynical. So I'm going to assume that people tell the truth, that they're not being looked over their shoulders. I don't remember the report really digging into the why some countries and regions have higher levels of engagement. So I share a little bit of the skepticism because, you know, when I used to work for the last large organization I used to work for, there's also this sort of elections throughout the years of employer of the year, that types of things. And a lot of organizations push motivated people to fill that in. They don't do it for them. So, but I'm really quite trusting in the fact that the Gallup Institute has done a good job. Okay, so thank you for in the meanwhile for answering entering some keywords. So at the heart of it is a lot of things with trust, autonomy, things that you recognize, purpose or a sense of purpose, leadership, empowerment, and so on. So thank you very much. All of these are actually really, really important. But in my view, my experience, something is needed first, even before that, because what I believe is that you first need an environment in which this can actually happen. And let me clarify what I mean with that. I don't know how familiar these types of situations is in Poland, but I'm going to assume it is an open office setup, meaning everybody working in large open offices with desks all in that sort of, can I call that factory style? And that is sort of not a really inspirational environment. Remember why we introduced Scrum. Because we are faced with highly unpredictable challenges, full of uncertainty, things that need to be figured out as we go along, and that are hardly predictable. What do we do then? We need different skills, different people with different backgrounds, different experience, different talents, different insights, whatever. We want to bring them together. And we want them to share stuff, interact, and together, collaboratively, figure out how to deal with complexity. In this environment, that is actually not happening because people are scared to speak up because somebody else will look angry or whatever. They do stupid things like sending a text message because they have a question for a colleague. they would maybe even use a mail for that, rather than just asking the question. On top of that, even if, what makes it even worse is a lot of companies have this thing called clean desk policies. If I translate that to an agile context, they would have clean wall policies. So the walls have to be clean. Not helpful if people want to figure out stuff together, do little design sessions, open up stuff and go to the walls. They need to use the walls, not just the desk, but even the walls. Nowadays, but that was already happening, but certainly nowadays with the COVID pandemic situation, there's a lot of telework. Now, this guy is working from the pool. It might look great, but actually it isn't. The problem with both situations, open offices, reinforced by the clean wall things, telework, is people are actually still disconnected. The problem is that we used to have like cubicles, everybody having their own little room between little walls that made sure that they were disconnected from each other. But you know what? The physical cubicles have been replaced by other cubicles, mental, psychological, whatever. But actually, there are still virtual cubicles over there. So people are still locked into their individual little space. This is not an environment. It looks great because it's harmonious, it's silent, it's whatever, but it's actually not helping engagement. It's even impeding engagement. So that sense of perfect harmony and this. Now, open offices, really great for office work, not for complex creative work for which we actually want to introduce Scrum. So not helpful. Telework, up to a point maybe, but you want to bounce off ideas against other people, want to share ideas, you want to talk to each other, figure out stuff together. And open offices, harmony, telework, not helpful. And that's what I mean with you need an environment, meaning you need a team space at least. You need a space beyond the open office, next to the open, whatever, where a team can actually talk to each other, figure out stuff together, work out things on the walls. And if you have a distributed team, you would still need a team space. It wouldn't be maybe a physical space. You might have physical spaces in different locations. And then you need that sort of virtual connection between people. Television screens on all the time. With modern communication technology, not a problem. Bandwidth enough. So you need that. You need a virtual or a physical workspace, a team space for people where they can talk, where they can organize their Scrum events, where they can do their daily Scrum, when they can put things on the wall and so on. So open offices, not helpful for engagement and not helpful for Scrum. So let's start with an environment. And that's a very difficult one because most of the large organizations that I've worked with, even in the recent past, are not open for the idea of team spaces because it's not in their power. They can't decide. Even the CIO say, I can't do anything about it. That's the facilities department, whatever. Yeah, fine. But the impact on the work, on the level of engagement of people and thereby on the productivity is huge. People do not engage with each other, meaning they don't figure out the right things. So that's what I mean with an environment. Now, imagine the following. So we understand the importance of engagement. We know what people are currently measuring, and I have no idea how velocity is a reflection of engagement. Might be, but at the same time, not really. You need to establish an environment in which then people can show trust, where there is actually safety or psychological safety, where they are empowered, even empowered to use the walls. Think about it, that's empowerment too, where people leave them alone, where they can talk, make a noise, where there's a healthy buzz in the room. Now imagine that in your company, people are seeing that, setting up an environment of Scrum, and then they want to have this idea of Scrum better implemented. And they ask for your opinion. Yeah, but if velocity, measuring velocity, productivity, output is not really helpful, what should we then measure in an environment of Scrum? What should we measure? So So I look forward to some of your ideas, some keywords. What would you prefer to monitor or measure in terms of business outcomes or the ability to produce business outcomes in an environment of Scrum, apart from what people are currently measuring? So imagine setting up an environment. What would you measure? Thank you. Morale, customer needs, employee satisfaction. NPS as probably a way to measure a customer satisfaction. So net promoter score. Happiness. Cool. Thank you. Business value.
Hinter question. Yep. You, because mm-hmm. now you used the word empowerment. Mm-hmm. But how does it differ from self-organizing team, actually? Because when we talk about self-organizing teams, also people a lot of time think that it means that they can organize their work in sprint. But actually, for me, it means also that if team needs that, they need to change something like space and so on, then they could do that, basically.
Yeah.
So do you see difference?
Well, it's a rather subtle difference, but empowerment actually is still a very, has this sense of hierarchy still a lot in it. If we empower people, we can also disempower them. So take the empowerment away again. In my book, it's very difficult to explain, but I also recently wrote a paper. By the way, it's called Moving Your Scrum Downfield. It's a small screen, I know. So Moving Your Scrum Downfield. And I think I repeated in my paper again what I said in my first book, so the Scrum Pocket Guide, that self-organization is, it happens. So that's not something, you don't need to empower people to self-organize. Because, like, I'll quote my paper for that. In my paper, it says self-organization is, it happens. Because any individual human being has the inherent quality to self-organize. So self-organization needs not be instructed nor empowered. So self-organization is, you have to unlock self-organization. So take away whatever is stopping, blocking, impeding people from self-organizing. And that's a very different thing than empowerment. Does that help, Christian?
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. So self-organization is, because it's something that we as human beings, we do. We do that all the time in our personal lives. Just in our professional lives, it seems that people don't trust us for that ability. So thank you for the keywords. So happiness, morale, NPS, lots of things, business value, cycle time. Cool. Great. And probably indeed important stuff. Now it's on there. This is again sort of the definition of Scrum I've used for that paper I just showed you. So moving your Scrum downfield. So the blow one. Scrum for me is a simple framework that enables people to derive value from complex challenges. The reason why we introduce Scrum, because of complexity, the problems that we're facing, the solutions that we need to create are highly complex, unpredictable, lots of uncertainties, emerging stuff all the time. That's why we introduce Scrum. That's why also we introduce Scrum, because of its simplicity, a simple, lightweight set of rules that will help us tackle complexity. It does not replace complexity with complicated situations. It's always complex, but the way we approach the problem is with a simple set of rules. But it's also about people, and the purpose in the end of Scrum is value, to derive value from complex challenges. So I strongly believe in taking value for a purpose. That's why you want to do Scrum, tackle complexity and get value out of it. If I translate that to what people are currently measuring, it often means that we need to ask people or get people to stop pushing for more output. More and output are about volume. That is very different from value. So also what I wrote in my paper, value is a very different purpose than volume. So we need to stop pushing for more and start working towards the right stuff, meaning we are going to create output, but we have to mind the impact that we generate from our output, so the outcome. And we need to optimize the output. And that means we need to start thinking in terms of value when we do Scrum. You can use Scrum, like a lot of companies do, to get more features out on the market faster. It still does not mean that you're building the right stuff with the right sense of appreciation or bringing enough value to the company, to the organization, to your users as well. So that's one of the huge shifts that we're looking for. It's not an easy shift. It's going to take time. Might take another 20 years of Scrum before we start getting there. But let's go for that. Let's keep striving for our dream. So we need some way to help managers to start thinking in terms of value instead of volume, instead of individual performance, instead of even team performance. So that's why we want to help people shift their focus, get their eyes away from the way that the Scrum team or the Scrum teams are performing, which is sort of the engine of your system. So it's not about the horsepower or the power or the whatever of your engine. It's about the impact that you're creating in terms of value. And that's for me very important, because imagine you can have an enormous, powerful engine, best car available, Formula One power, whatever. The goal, the purpose of management in a servant leadership environment is not to tweak the engine even more. It's to make sure that you're driving in the right direction, that all obstacles are removed, that you don't have to stop before traffic lights like every 50 meters, because you can have a beautiful, powerful engine. If you have those obstacles, if you're driving in the wrong direction, west instead of east, not helpful. And that's the problem with volume and performance thinking. Now, a long time ago in my time at Scrum to Talk, we called this total framework agility path. The term is not being used anymore, and nobody remembers anyhow, except a couple of old people like myself. But that was the essential idea. Hey, dear managers, stakeholders, CFO, CEO, whatever, stop breathing down people's neck, getting them to do more. Help them find direction, goals, objectives, and make sure that any hindrances that they meet, that those get removed. And then think about what is the impact, what is the value that is being delivered in a way. And that might be reflected in the idea of, imagine, because at that touch point of Scrum and the two feedback cycles of Scrum, with the larger feedback cycle around value, at that touch point is actually the sprint review. And imagine that your stakeholders would come to the sprint review not thinking in terms of, I'm going to ask justifications from everybody in the team that they actually did their work, that they did their tasks, that they lived up to their estimates and so on. Imagine stakeholders, other people coming to the sprint review, wondering about how much potential, how much value has this team or have these teams created in the sprint. Meaning the hidden messages, and it's also, I've made that explicit in my paper, the hidden messages and explicit message in my paper is the units to measure in and to count in from an external perspective of Scrum, so not the Scrum team itself, is a team, a sprint, and value. So it's not about individuals, it's not about individual tasks, it's not about estimates, it's about value, the team, and a sprint. So those are the units to think of and to work with. And imagine at the sprint review, starting with this question, your sprint review revolving around this question, you would have a very different atmosphere. So think about it. Now, that's only step one. Step two would be to help people think in terms of value and give them some ideas. I've called them samples, possible measurements, metrics, and I think you will recognize quite a lot of them from what you just entered into the word cloud with my question. So This is, again, long time ago from agility path. I think it's now called evidence-based management. It's got a fourth domain. I still think of value in three domains. First of all, current value, so actual value at this point in time. You see that value. And then the domain that I call adaptability is more like repeat value. What is your ability to sustain the value? Meaning you can have a high current value, and just a simple example, if you're only releasing like once a year, you've got no guarantee at all that you will be able to sustain that value. So that's only one of the examples. So it's about adaptability. But imagine high current value, so a lot of value being produced, a high ability to sustain that value, that's still you might still go out of business. Think of what happened a long time ago with a couple of mobile phone producers and so on. They got out of touch, so they stopped thinking and discovering new value. So that's innovation. So we've got actual value, repeat value, can you repeat that, and new value. And that should be the goal of introducing something like Scrum. Are you creating room to think in terms of value? Now, at the highest level of those key value indicators, and again, there are samples, there are just examples that we see coming up a lot, but you have to think for your situation, to your product that you're building, your service that you're offering, your context, your consumer base, your organization, your technology, your people, your teams, what are good indicators of value for us? Now, at the highest level, in terms of actual current value, when I go into organizations and I ask people about this, so at the CXO level, in general, they always come up with something of money and something with consumers or customers. Yeah? I've called it financial returns, might be some increased profit and so on. But just think about it. So if you get people to think in terms of value, so away from performance of the team, of the engine, and then looking at the road direction and the impact you're having from the power that you're that you have at your disposal, maybe these are indicators that you want to introduce. Now,
Hinder, there's a question. Yes. And the question is why? So it says that focus on value and outcome should be obvious for executives and C-level people, but in practice, it's not. So why you think it happened or happens?
Well, the funny thing is I mostly see it not happening. So I totally buy into your observation. That's why it's one of the most difficult shifts. And that is sort of in my book, I've called it upstream adoption. Management realizing that becoming an agile organization, a flexible, responsive organization, an innovative organization is more than just getting more building, constructing more agile teams. It's actually rethinking your organization. So introducing Scrum and then rethinking a lot of practices around Scrum, like what are you measuring? What is productivity? What is performance? And these are some ideas to get across to them. So I certainly have no magical solution to get people to understand this. At every CXO management team level, but also the teams, so the link you would like to have between Scrum teams and stakeholders, managers to get this idea is obviously the product owner, right? So the Scrum Master as a servant leader to bring these ideas, but then a product owner to be a living example of this, leading by example, and measuring performance in terms of value, meaning altering product backlog for value and using the criterion of value continuously as the way to explain why product backlog is ordered like that. At the sprint review, thinking in terms of value, what is the sort of impact that we're trying to create with this increment? So output increment, outcome, impact or value. So, and it's going to take a while before we get there. But I do agree with the question that this should be the natural task of managers and stakeholders. But for some reason, it's not happening because everybody is focused on the performance, the engine, the horsepower. It's going to take a while before we can shift their focus away from that. Yeah. Now, from the survey, it turns out that focusing on engagement really has an effect. So we've got all these beautiful metrics in place, and they found out in the report that companies with a high level of engagement versus companies with a low level of engagement, that there were some substantial differences in a number of metrics, like outbound metrics, like those customer metrics that we talked about, NPS scores, customer satisfaction, productivity, so the ability to do more sales figures, which is a financial metric, profitability and so on, a lot higher. And then on the other side, which is something I like to focus on a lot, the number of burnouts was less, lower absenteeism, less people leaving the company, which is actually really important. So focusing on engagement really, really has an impact. And that's why I'm saying, if we would look at actual value, financial returns, customer satisfaction, in whatever metrics you would pour that, and in team engagement, my challenge for people is to focus only on team engagement. And that's why I'm saying team engagement is the key. Because imagine that 85% of your workforce is in general. And if that's in the US, that would be 69%. That is still a lot of people. Imagine a company of 1,000 people, that is in the US, 690 people, or in general case, 850 people not engaged for the company. Imagine the potential that you have over there. That is huge. And as you've seen in the figures, focusing on team engagement actually results in better financial returns and in better customer metrics. So that's the challenge. Go for team engagement. Foster an environment, create an environment where people can actually engage. So create an environment, team spaces, dedicated workspaces, dedicated teams, allow people to do their job. So allow them to use their natural ability to self-organize and then get sort of control from boundaries. So but let's look at those metrics again. And this connects, or let me use this as sort of intermediate statement. So from the what I call exploratory management of value, so moving away from looking at teams onto value via a number of metrics, that's fine, great. But it is still sort of what I call in Scrum, that's the inspection part of the feedback loop. Just inspection is not helpful. You need to do more. It's all about adaptation. So like sprints in Scrum, that feedback loop on top of your Scrum zone on value, just inspecting value and inspecting impact is not enough. What are you going to do with it? How are you going to use that as a basis to do something with? So it's all about adaptation. And the adaptation that we're looking for is, again, a management shift. Stop managing for tasks and individual performance. Not helpful. And it's not going to increase engagement more. So start creating, fostering, developing an environment, a bounded environment. So an environment that has boundaries, but within the environment, great freedom, openness for people to actually do what they love to do, to engage. It has a focus in Scrum. It's about a product. It's about product development. It's about service delivery to the market, to users. Stop breathing down people's neck. So create something where people can actually engage. So that's a challenge. And so inspection without adaptation. So that's about closing the loops. Make sure that you think about adaptation. So we try to get people to move away from looking at the performance of teams into what is the impact of the work of those teams via key value indicators. And then look at those things. It's a loop. So do that regularly so that you have multiple measurements. You see trends, you see evolutions, you see things happening. So that will help you get away, sort of get a more helicopter view and get away from individual measured values. That might turn it into KPIs again. It's not the idea. And then what are you going to do with that? So, and then the goal is like, imagine that your sprint reviews would start from how much value has this team potentially created in this sprint, and then try to converge towards, by the end of the sprint review, to, okay, so what can we now do to help this team or these teams create more value in the next couple of sprints? Bring in market changes, ideas, useful feedback, valuable feedback in a way, help them figure out, ask questions, look for, do you have lacking authorizations? Do you have all the right tools? Do you have a team space that you can use? Do you have the right skills in place? How about knowledge? Do you need to go on some courses? Do you need some things? Are you working according to the right standards and so on? So this is where facilitation comes in. So servant leadership, so managers becoming servant leaders and helping teams figure out, oh, what can we do to help you build more value in the next couple of sprints? And that is a very different discussion again than sort of leaving the sprint review, leaving the team in a state of despair over the fact that, oh my God, next sprint we're going to have to deliver more or all or whatever. Again, it's not about volume, it's about value. So sprint review should be about team value sprint, both the inspection as well as the adaptation. And then you would hope that teams have sufficient psychological safety to bring up concerns, impediments that they're suffering from, to help stakeholders run around through the organization, knowing that, oh my God, if they can install that test platform, or if they have authorizations over there, or if we get more skills in the team, we help them acquire new additional skills, they would actually do an even better job in the next sprint. So that's about closing the loop. So that's sort of, don't just do measurements. It's about what you do with the information that you derive from those measurements. So it's all about value. Now, I see agile as a really important way to unlock that engagement, because it not just thrives on empiricism, meaning the process of regular inspections, adaptation, but empiricism goes hand in hand with self-organization. And that seems to be very difficult. So slowly, that first 25 years of Scrum, slowly people are getting the idea, I think, of empiricism, inspection, adaptation. And that's becoming the sort of natural replacement of the old school predictive waterfall types of things in at least a number of organizations. But a lot of those organizations still have difficulty going for real self-organization, understanding that control in Scrum comes from the boundaries, going to the sprint review, leaving the team alone for a full sprint. Wow, full sprint, it's only 2 weeks of work. And going to the sprint review, and going to the sprint review not to judge people, to assess people, to get them to justify what they've done, but to help them figure out what can we do, or figure out for themselves what can we do to help you even more. So this whole agile thing is for me a huge way to unlock engagement, but that seems to be very difficult. So I've got one more closing question for you. What do you think in your organizations, what is in your observation currently the biggest impediment to agile? If I see agile as a way to unlock engagement, so what is the biggest impediment to agile in your organization? And Christian, if you have some questions popping up, so maybe that could be a good point in time too.
I don't have questions popping up on the Q&A, but I was wondering, because a few times I heard you said that you kind of, I believe, you meet now people in organizations that start to think differently, and they start to look, okay, Scrum is kind of working. How can we benefit more of that?
Yeah. And as a process, in a way. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, as a process. So that would be also my question. Like, it's my observation. I wonder if it's also yours, that it comes, it's like a learning path that comes with experience. And in organizations that they're used to work in Scrum way, like it's the new status quo, then at some point the management start to ask different questions. What do you think about it?
Yeah, absolutely. And I see this as the biggest next step that we're going to have to take. And it's going to take some sort of active attitude from people like ourselves, scrum masters, coaches, to get that idea across. I'll give you a very concrete example. So in the last large organization I worked with, I was sort of on and off coaching 15 teams from their whatever amount of teams that they had in place. They were getting the idea of scrum. So working in sprints and so on, that was all getting along, sprint plannings and so on. They didn't have team spaces, so they had to do everything in meeting rooms, which was a huge problem for me. But from those 15 teams, I saw a couple of teams really growing in collaboration and results. And they were actually able to self-organize at the level that I call self-management, meaning organize their own work in a sprint. But they were still facing the problem that there was a lack of team stability. That means regularly other people, resource managers, HR people, sometimes a PMO, whatever, pulled people from a certain team to put them into a different team. And that again undermined the motivation of people to really go for it. And that in a way undermines the real benefits of Scrum. So we need to start focusing on this self-organization aspect more and more and more. And that's in a way the people aspect. So next to process, empiricism, that sort of self-organization, meaning the people aspect of Scrum. And we need to sort of get them at the same level.
Also like more people, not resources, because if you think that you can pull somebody from one team and plug the person in another team, that it's thinking in terms of resources, pretty
yes.
much, right?
Yes, and that is still a problem. And people, like you say, are not resources. In my book, I think I've called in my papers again, I keep stressing that people are people, not resources, not replaceable pieces of machinery. I was trying to make that sort of tangible by saying you have a team, it's composed of a number of people, and those people are more than just summaries or lists of technical skills. They have personalities, they have characters, they have a sense of humor or a total absent sense of humor, like myself. And once they become a well-oiled team, sort of self-organizing ecosystem that is fluent, pulling out somebody from that fluent system is a huge problem. And a lot of people think, yeah, but we're going to replace that person with a similar person, meaning the same technical skills. And even if that person would have the same CV, the same training, same experience and so on, that will still be a very different individual to work with. And that's the thinking. A team is not a machine of parts of a machine where you can replace one part with a similar different part. It's way more complex than that. Yeah.
So there is one more question. Mm-hmm. It's actually about how the understanding of the value that has been produced by the team actually impacts the engagement. And how do you build that link?
Yeah, so value is a lot in the hands of product owners. So ordering product backlog based upon value, stop pressuring people to do more as a product owner, but start working with the team so that they build the right stuff, the things that are really high priority now that will, in your view, as a product owner, would bring you the most value. And if again, an example from the work floor, if by the end of the sprint, they still have 1 or 2 days left and they're ready, they've built all of the value that you agreed above, they implemented the forecast. As a product owner, wouldn't it be great to just, okay, stop. So we'll keep the sprint review in place because that's a fixed time box. In the meantime, use those 1 or 2 days to do something else. Investigate, research, do a little spike, do whatever, something with technology, something that you like, rather than pushing for more scope and more volume. That's sort of the attitude and the work atmosphere that we're looking for. As a product owner, if they build sort of the highest value, cool, take that to your stakeholders at the sprint review, check with them, verify with them, see if they have better ideas, if they have other opinions, if they know about important changes that are coming, that are happening on the market with competitors and so on. So one of the key roles in this is actually the product owner. By doing that, you're sending out a signal to people, to teams, to development teams, that they're actually doing a great job. They don't feel pushed. All work that we do, certainly creative, cognitive work, needs some sort of slack. You need room. So one of the words is on the screen is called capacity planning. That is actually indeed a huge problem. You can leave sprint planning with a fully planned sprint. Everybody's available hours have been calculated. Sprint backlog has been calculated. It has matched and so on. That is not a guarantee at all that you will have a successful sprint. Capacity planning utilization is not part of working with people. Just think of it. I get often the best ideas staring out the window, going for a walk, under the shower, doing a little run, taking the dog for a walk, and so on. So that's what we need in creative cognitive environments. People need slack time, meaning room to think about other ways to do the same work in a better way. If capacity planning, utilization, that just fills up people's mind up front, and it kills all room for creativity and innovation. And by creating that room, we create a more, and that's one of my big things as an independent scrum caretaker, we create a more humanized workplace, a workplace that people love to come to because they're not being pressured all the time. They don't end up in a burnout every three sprints. They don't end up being depressed. They don't resign from the company. You've got some long-term engagement happening. And as we've seen in the report, engagement really leads to better figures. And by the way, report or not, we actually believe that because we all agree that employees who are engaged actually care a lot more about outcomes and so on. So I want to thank you very much. We're sort of at the end of our time, I believe. So let me share this as a closing. So for me, the biggest impediment I see to Agile, and you will see that reflected in a lot of the keywords that came up, is our ingrained obsession with controlling individuals. That is huge. It's a remainder. It remains from the industrial age. It is a reflection of our idea of people as resources, people as mindless, dumb workers on an old school, 100 years ago, manufacturing production line. That's not helpful in a creative, cognitive context. You want people using their brains. You want to create a room, an environment, but also a psychological environment where people feel free to use their brains, try out, do an experiment, learn from the experiment, do something else, meanwhile optimizing for value. And that is very different from controlling individuals. Use Scrum to establish what we call a complex adaptive system, where you can't, in a very reductionist way, try to deduce who's done what and how have you as an individual. No, it's about the whole. So should we go through any more questions?
There's one question I think you answered already. How long it's going to take? I think you said maybe next 20 years.
Yeah, might be. I'm always reminded, Christian, so when I was at Scrum the Talk, so in my regular contacts with Ken, so Ken Schwaber, he always reminded us of the fact that, you know what, guys, when we started out with this thing, Scrum, early 90s, 1995, the Agile Manifesto, we would have never imagined all the things that have been happening in the meanwhile. Yes, obviously, our dreams were even a lot more. see what happened. So starting with that belief, I think is a really great idea. Sticking to your beliefs is not bad. And imagine that in those early years, this was really, really a strange message. So we have come a long way. Let's try to keep traveling.
Yeah, and in what you said, it sounds to me also like, and I believe that also who is the product owner is crucial. And in the questions, we could see also that people ask about what if the product owner is not engaged and so on. And we tend to focus very much on team. And when we get engaged with companies, it's always like we do everything okay, but the team is not performing. But maybe it's time to look also at the product owner. Do you have the right person? Is the product owner empowered to be product owner? Does he manage budgeting actually? Has money, any money?
Right. And that for me already starts, Christian, with a step before that. That's what I miss with most organizations, actually, if not all, that nobody thinks about what is our product. What is your product? So you have a product backlog, you have a product owner. What is actually your product? And again, in my paper, Moving the Scrum Downfield, I've tried to emphasize that a little bit more. I'll just share a little quote. So product is the vehicle for the product owner to deliver value. Without a clearly identified product, a product owner can hardly be effective in optimizing for value, and Scrum is hardly used effectively. So think about it. What is your product? Because that is connected to what we just talked about, value product. What is the impact? And what is the sort of level or the range or the product ownership? And that is really important. Most organizations, certainly large organizations, they establish teams within existing silos, existing departments, and those teams often work on maybe components are parts of a product. There is no overall view over the complete product. And that often means that teams create an increment, but it's not actually an increment of product, it's an increment that they throw over to another team. And they also throw it over to another team. That is still, so it seems superficially, it looks like they're doing Scrum, but are they getting the most out of Scrum? No. Because there's still a lot of delays, handovers, waste, and there's no optimization for value, actually.
So it's kind of like mechanical Scrum or like Barry Irving called it zombie Scrum.
Yeah, although I'm not a fan of those things because we abandoned Scrum Buds a long time ago. I would prefer not to introduce Scrum Bud again, where we assess, judge, whatever, blame people for, yeah, you're saying that. They are actually doing Scrum. They've got probably all of the events, all of the roles in place. I like to think in terms of, okay, so you're now doing Scrum, and what can we do more? So Scrum and. So what can we do more? What is your product backlog for? How can we use product backlog even more effectively? How can we have an even more effective product owner in a way? By defining your product, by having a product vision. So that's I like to focus on the road ahead and not blaming people for where they actually stand.
Great. We have one more question, I see. Could teams become more involved if team members are to a greater extent responsible for prioritization of the work and selecting outcomes on to focus on? In other words, could POs help by delegating more?
Yeah, absolutely. So Gregos, absolutely. I'll try to explain why and how in a very, hopefully very tangible, almost actionable way. So in my paper also described, so Moving Your Scrum Downfield, that I would love to have product owners that use their product backlog to manage things I would call business solutions, envisioned capabilities for users and consumers, functions, not old school requirements. The decomposition of solutions, functions, capabilities into requirements are actually something for the team. It's something for the team. It's more, that is for me part of development. That is not part of the product owner role. So we invite development team members to use their creativity and their insights into how development actually works, to not just accept requirements from the product owner, but think through and talk through envisioned capabilities of the product owner and work with the product owner to then decompose them. Oh yeah, that means you're envisioning this, if we could build it like that. And whether you make those requirements then old school requirements, use cases, small use cases, user stories, whatever, I don't care. But sort of, if you would have a product owner indeed, and really happy with your question, that has a product backlog almost at that level, although it's not really about level, at that level, that would be an invitation for development team people to use their creativity and intelligence and their professionalism to decompose that into tangible work. And that might end up with acceptance criteria or acceptance test-driven development and so on. But that part of decomposing that work, that is actually development work. And it's only respectful that we allow people to do that work, which is actually part of their profession or their practice, meaning development people. Yeah. No, I hope that helps you see that, oh yeah, that brings a very different balance in the relationship between a product owner and a development team. And it opens up, it's an invitation for a development team to do a lot more than just implement requirements that were sort of mentally thrown over the wall again.
Yeah, we've seen that happening just now with the COVID outbreak with one of our customers, and it was because they had no time anymore to do the typical analysis, and they had to give to teams like, we need this feature build or this capability build. Yeah. And they were extremely surprised that teams could deliver, and they could deliver actually much faster than based on specification or requirements before.
My hope would then be that they would make that a sort of normal way of working once the crisis is over. Because that's often a problem you also see with Scrum, that organizations almost naturally revert to something that looks a lot like Scrum in a situation of crisis, some immediate urgency, whatever.
Yeah.
They set up a war room, whatever, and they start working in a way that you would look from the outside and say, hey, this is actually the principles of Scrum. So, and I hope that they would see the value of turning that into their normal way of working.
Great. Thank you. Thank you for that, Ginter. Thank you very much for sharing your thoughts. As always, very inspirational.
So thank you, Andre, Christian, for inviting me. Thank you, everybody, for attending. So thank you, and see you guys again.
See you again.
Hey, thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.